Hello there, friends. Andrea with the Bangs here, and today on She Wonders Why, we will be talking about a very non-controversial and easy topic, that of the film Cuties that came out a couple weeks ago on Netflix. My guest today is Cassidy Poling. She's one of my friends from my Bridges of Meaning Discord group, and she's also a filmmaker. She has knowledge and understanding as to what exactly went into making this film, the thoughts behind it, the context that it was made in, and I had some questions just to shed some light on this particular film and wanted to discuss with someone who is an expert on these matters. Cuties is something I thought was one thing, until I started reading a friend of mine live tweeting her experience of watching the film, and it seemed different from what I initially thought. So I think it's important to know what you're dealing with, you look into the context, and you can still not end up watching it if you don't want to, but it seemed like people were sort of dismissing it as it must be evil because of the poster, and I wanted to investigate further. So I hope you enjoy this discussion. It sheds quite a bit of light on what was going on with this film. And please share your opinion on what you think. And if you are new, please remember to subscribe. You tell me.
That's fine.
Okay.
You can do first and last thing. Okay. That's fine. Gives me credibility.
Okay.
I'm a filmmaker. I've got a last name.
Now that we've figured out, I'm introducing my next guest. Here is my next guest, Cassidy Poling. Hello, Cassidy.
Hello. Thanks for having me on. Oh my gosh, you have mugs.
Yeah. Oh, mugs. Mug. No, girl, it's mug. Like, well, actually, it does have a twin. My YouTube mentor, Benjamin Boyce, was gifted one of these at Christmas by me. So there's two. Right. Like, there's. I do Twin need mugs. To get this. It was like maybe I'll get these made and a store made someday. So this is like a goal someday when I
it's
feel
aspirational.
Feel like people want it enough. So yeah. Anyway. Yeah. So okay, so we have been brought here today by one of the most controversial things I've seen on Twitter, like, since Trump got elected. Like, maybe. Wow. Okay, so we're talking about Cuties, guys. But first, I need to talk to Cassidy about her credentials and why I chose her to speak to me about this.
Yeah, so a little background. I'm a filmmaker. I got my degree in cinema.
Sorry, one of my children just walked in and I just pointed at the door and snapped. They should know what that means.
So I got my degree in cinema from San Francisco State University. So as much as I talk very confidently about everything, it's the one thing I have, like, license to talk about with some authority.
Right.
So
yes. And I will give you that. Yes.
Yes, I have a very expensive piece of paper that tells me I know something about this.
Yes.
So I'm believing it.
So can you give, I know this sounds sort of like, well, I know you have the expensive piece of paper, but, like, why do we listen to you over others? But it is helpful to give a bit more of a sort of an example that I can understand of what it is you learn in film school, as opposed to just being a critic as a regular film goer.
I always make the joke, I'm like, I'm a glorified movie watching
maker.
So, like, all I do is sit around and watch movies. But you do learn more than just that in film school. You learn about film theory, so different techniques of what makes certain films more technically proficient than others. Mm-hmm. What filmmakers do to evoke emotion in people. There's just different things that you learn as far as technique.
Okay.
And then you also learn about film history.
Okay.
So where it started, where has it gone? You see all of these movements and you're also not just watching film history from the US, which is what a lot of people who are just general moviegoers are going to see. You're also watching films from all over the world and learning about the different styles and how they've adapted and how and like context. Those have influenced others. And how those influence other styles of film. So you learn a lot about the holistic picture of what how we got what we have today. Can you hear that dog barking?
Yes, he just sounds like he loves you. It makes me feel better about my kid coming in quick. Like, my kids never come in, and I was actually like, what are you? You know mommy's recording. So it makes me feel better. It's not just me.
Not just you. I'm also, like, a terrible guest.
No!
Worst
I'm a
etiquette.
Terrible host, and you're a terrible guest, and we put it together. So, with regards, let's get down to it. I'm actually, okay, I'm going to give what... the sequence of events from my perspective on Twitter, because it was very much on Twitter. So the the promo, I'll probably throw up a picture of the promo if I can find it, which I probably can. Poster in the US. It was terrible. Like, they chose the worst possible. Did you see it? It was the girls in their dance outfits doing like poses that were provocative. As 11-year-olds, it was the worst possible, because we also, people like didn't have any context. So they were like, oh, this is a movie about these girls. Like, you had no idea what was going on. So there was a huge backlash just over that. And then they showed the promo picture for the Paris one, or not Paris, sorry, for the French one. And then it's like showed them as girls running down the street, and it looked a lot more wholesome, and people were like, oh, okay, we'll give it that, like, at least in my space. And then it came out and a lot of people saw it and were like, nah, still just like, may as well just have had the same reaction as I did to the original provocative promo poster. I don't know what any good is from this thing. So I saw some people live tweet it. Actually, the person who live tweeted it is one of my good friends on Twitter. Her name's Miss Fitpoise. And she she live tweeted it quite in order and in quite a bit of detail. And she's the reason why I actually was more interested in watching it, because it was much more nuanced than I thought. So it was just very much divided. Some people were, this is actually, brings attention to problems in social media and pressure on girls, blah, blah, blah. And then others were like, sexualizing girls even more. It did the thing it said it was trying to teach us about, against or whatever. So that's the context I have come at it from. And I did watch it and whatever. But there was quite an impression in the Twitter sphere on it, so.
Right, and I'm not on Twitter. Okay. I can't handle it. I can barely handle the social media I have now. The only reason I have it is for business stuff, but so I saw things on YouTube. Okay. And so when I first heard about it, I saw the screenshots of the videos from all of these conservative pundits, and honestly, I didn't want to watch them because I was kind of annoyed, because it felt like this weird echo chamber thing going on. And it started with the whole Nicki Minaj WAP song, where everyone freaked out on like the conservative YouTube sphere about that. Yeah. And every single person was talking about it. And I was like, what is this echo chamber crap? Like, it's an absurd song.
Yeah.
But why is everyone talking about it? And then all of a sudden I see this thing with Cuties, and it's like,
more
what's going on here? I just don't even want
to
listen.
And there are people saying, I forgot that to say that earlier. People saying, I won't watch it. I will not watch it. Like, people in the I won't even give it a chance camp. Yeah.
Right. And so I didn't know what it was about. I had no context. All I saw was pieces from the poster, from these like screenshots of these YouTube videos. And looking at those pictures, it did look like some weird, like, comedy dance drama with, like, little girls, like a Bring It On for children.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, that's weird. And then I was just on Netflix and I saw the Cuties movie. And for some reason, I just scrolled over it and watched the trailer. And when I watched the trailer, I think that was the first time I realized, okay, there's something bigger going on here. Because what I would see on Facebook and stuff is like, cancel Netflix. They're like creating content that's like promoting pedophilia, cancel Netflix. Mm-hmm. And I'm watching it and I'm like, okay, something's off. Mm-hmm. But I didn't watch it. I didn't have time. Mm-hmm. And then I was on the Bridge of Meaning Discord and there was people getting in arguments about that. And someone posted an article about that. And when I read that article, there were certain things without even watching the film that made me go, oh, okay, there's a lot more going on here. And like, we're treating this issue like it's black and white. And I'm pretty sure that it's very gray. Okay. So I have watched the film now and we can kind of get into my personal thoughts about that later. Mm-hmm. But I think before you can even talk about the film, you really do have to talk about the context and what's going on with it before we can really have like a discussion of what the debate should be and what the debate is and how to make that debate better.
Okay, so can we, yes, so let's go into the context. For I will start with saying, because I was confused about it, it is not a documentary. I thought it was, and I can't remember if people said it was a documentary or if I made some assumptions. So I don't want to blame people for my thoughts about it in that, but I just thought it was a documentary, and it's not. It is not. It's a film that was made purposefully. And I watched, there's a little bit of a, I think it's a 6-minute sort of explanation from the director. And it's a woman who directed it. I think she wrote it as well, because it's from her perspective. She's from where?
Senegal.
Yes, she's from Senegal. So she grew up in that sort of two worlds space. And then she actually saw a little dance troupe perform a very over-sexualized performance.
Routine.
Yeah, I'm like, what's the word? Routine. Yeah. And then she found out they were 11 and she was like, what? They're 11. So it was a mix of her own background and then seeing this actually happen in real life and then putting it together into a realistic looking, it looks documentary-ish.
Right.
Please go
for it. So it's a narrative film. Mm-hmm. So it was written and cast, but it's in a realism. It's in the style of realism. And that all stems from Italian neorealism, which was a movement that started post-World War II. So,
wait, it didn't start with mockumentary with The Office?
It did not start with The Office. Okay. Sorry, we're not going back to what, 2008, a little bit further.
I had to put that in.
Yeah. Okay. So
Italian realism.
Italian neorealism was born out of post-World War II Italy. In America, there was a lot of this sensationalizing of filmmaking, and it was a sort of escapism culture. And first of all, the Italians did not have the resources to make those kind of films just because they didn't have the budgets. Their cities are destroyed. They just have very limited resources on what they can do. So part of that was born out of just their circumstances. But another part of it was to break away from this escapism theme that was going on in filmmaking and highlight realities and put a light on issues that were happening in the day today and trying to get people to care about them. So a lot of the styles and some of the characteristics of Italian neorealism films is they're shot on location. So when you're watching those films, you're seeing the destruction in Italy that happened in the wars. Okay. And they usually hire non-professional actors who have experienced whatever scenario that they're living in real life. So usually for that time, it was poor working class people. And there's a lot of stylistic choices in the way that they film it, where it's long takes, very realistic. They're not trying to sensationalize anything. A lot of times there's small moments that, you know, in a regular film would be cut because, you know, it doesn't get straight to the story, but it's part of the pacing to create this sort of realistic feel. And the whole point of it is to reflect what's going on in the times and make a call to action to say, hey, there's some injustice that's happening right in front of our faces and we're not doing anything about it.
Okay. Oh, so that's even baked right into the style. Okay.
Right. And so that style influences the realism that we see in modern times. So there's plenty of films. This is not the only film that plays in that style. But a lot of them have those similar characteristics. As a more modern, although it's not so modern anymore, but in, I think it was 1994, the film Kids was released. And that's one of the best examples of like a more modern kind of like Italian neorealistic style. Mm-hmm. But that's about sexuality too. And children.
Oh, okay.
So it's much worse than Cuties.
Oh, I didn't see that one, but.
Oh my gosh.
Okay.
It's, I don't necessarily recommending everybody go watch it. It's a very, very, there are parts of it that's very graphic. Okay. And it's very disturbing. It's one of the only films I've left with like literal pit in my stomach.
Okay, then. I don't like, know. Okay. Was there a backlash against that one?
On. You know, I don't know. Oh, okay. I should have looked that up. There probably was, but I'm not sure.
No,
but I watched it in film school, and it was, it's a doozy.
Yeah, okay.
But so there is a pattern of that, and you can see that in filmmaking today. That style is still really influential. Okay. So it's not. That's part of what you're saying, where it's like a lot of it felt sort of documentarian-ish or very realistic. Mm-hmm. That's the point. It's shot to
feel real,
make you feel, make you feel like you're entering this real world, which although they are fake characters, it's a fictional story. These stories are existing. Mm-hmm. This is actually happening in modern times with real people. Mm-hmm. And so that's what it's trying to provoke in you.
Okay.
The other thing that sort of made me kind of realize, oh, maybe there's something going on a little bit more than this than people are admitting, was when I heard that it was French. Mm-hmm. I don't watch a ton of French films, but the French films that I have seen, especially the modern French films, use a lot of very graphic imageries and sometimes almost subtle ways to really shock the audience and to make critiques about social issues. So Caché would be a film that would be an example. That was it's like a thriller, but the point of it was to criticize some event that happened in French history and kind of critique the fact that they were ignoring it. Mm. And so there are some very graphic scenes that come out of nowhere and you're just like, whoa, but it makes a very powerful statement on what the underlying point is. And sometimes you even miss it. Like, I had to learn about the history to even understand what was really going on because I don't know French history.
Oh, that's interesting.
I don't really know. So that film's very interesting where if you watched it without any background, you might not really understand what's going on.
Right.
But when you learn more about the history of it, you start to realize, oh, there's something a lot deeper here.
We're so used to just going to the movies for entertainment and like, I had to do research before. Are you kidding me?
How dare you? You know, like how dare you make me look up things and understand different cultures. But yeah, Elle would be another French film, also a thriller, and that one actually has some critiques on, you know, hypersexualization, rape, different things that they do it in this very, like, there are some of these images that are so graphic, but the way that they're doing, putting it together and cutting the film has some really brilliant, like, they say things about the way that we handle those issues that you could never really communicate outside of that medium. And it really is very interesting, but again, it's very graphic. And so I think for Americans who aren't necessarily seeing those graphic images in that context, it can be a little
jarring,
ruffle some feathers.
Yes. Okay. And you're not necessarily saying, so it's totally fine. And so since it's French, it's totally, no. Yeah, just to be clear, this is just what it is. You're just stating what the background is.
Yeah, I'm not making any judgments right. about it. That's just the fact of right. what it is. And so we need to understand that. And we understand that this woman is probably playing, well, she's definitely playing in this realm of Italian neorealism, mm-hmm. using those techniques, you know, and in some ways I completely understand that as a filmmaker, it makes mm-hmm. sense. You know, it's like you watch those high school movies where the high schoolers are obviously like in mm-hmm. their 20s. This movie wouldn't work right, if you did right. that, right?
Oh yeah, it would be like, oh, they're just being a little bit provocative and they're 20, so
right.
that's what they choose to do. Yeah, yeah, but right. but the fact that's the point is that they're like they're 11. Yeah,
right. And she's using that technique in her social statement to say that, and the fact that she is French, and whether it's good or not, their films are a little more risque.
Okay, so
they've got a different culture.
So we should maybe go, unless there's more context. Okay, do you want to give a little quick synopsis of what the story is about? Because again, if I hadn't read my friend's little play-by-play, I would have no idea what it's about. So,
right.
Because it just seems so like provocative. So.
Yeah. So basically it follows this girl, Amy. She's 11 years old. She's from, her parents are immigrants from
Senegal.
Senegal. And yes, Muslim family, and her mom is having to deal with the fact that her dad is bringing in a second wife. So there's this story there going on about her dealing with this idea of having this other woman come into their family and see her mom deal with the issues that come with that, while also having this parallel story of her trying to fit in and be accepted by the people at her school. And she tries to get in with this group of girls. They call themselves the Cuties. And they're this group of girls who have this little dance troupe, and they obviously dress outside their age group.
And, alter tops are their thing. Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of inappropriate clothes for the age group. And they do these dances that are a little bit provocative. So it's basically following this journey of her getting sucked into this world and seeing how the things that she's watching online and the people she's watching online are, in a sense, rewiring her brain to think and act in this way that is outside of what you would expect an 11-year-old to act mm-hmm. like. And so, yeah, it's very interesting to
think. And the more provocative, because they don't think, this is the thing that really struck me, is the dance moves that she has like stolen her cousin's phone. So the other girls don't really have phones. She's the one who has access then to YouTube and to these music videos. And
right. The
more provocative the moves, then she presents them to the other girls, the more they're excited about it, and the more they're like, oh, come be part of our group even more because you brought the new moves. Right. And to them, it's just new moves. It's not, I don't even think they think, oh, it's more provocative. I think they're like, oh, these are new moves we've never seen before. They don't even, the concept isn't even in their heads about what is this communicating to the outside world.
Right. I think they have no idea that stuff is even really sexualized.
Right.
Right.
It's cool.
It's things they're seeing.
It's just cool. It's like, oh, we're cool. And also they don't want to be little girls. Like they get really, really upset. One of the girls actually gets kicked out of the group because She exposes one of the turns on the webcam when they were talking to a boy who they were trying to make him think that they were older, and then the girl turned on the camera and they got mad. She's like, "Oh, he turned the camera on, so now he saw me, and now you're out of the group." And it's like, and you know, he thinks I'm a little girl. It's like, you are a little girl. Like, it's so, and
Yeah.
they it's so sad because it's like they're 11.
Yeah.
And
Well,
sorry, you were saying?
it's very, you're watching it and it's very shocking. And I think what needs to be said, and that what I don't think often what is being said when we're having this conversation is it's supposed to be. That's the point. You're supposed to be upset. You're supposed to be disturbed. This is not a glamorization. And where I think this is getting lost is people keep saying she's just creating content for pedophiles. Like she's supporting pedophiles, which I think is a mischaracterization of what she's actually doing. She's trying to criticize the culture that makes content available that pedophiles and creeps all over the world can get their hands on. That's a very different thing than saying, oh, she's just making a show that's glorifying this. And that's what's getting heard by some of these people, and what's there's a disconnect in that conversation. So for the people who haven't watched it, this is not a glorification of this sort of behavior, this sort of creation of media. It's the opposite. Now, of course, there is an argument to be had about the ethics of what we capture on film and what we put out, but that's a totally different conversation. And I have some reasons why I don't think that's the first conversation we should be having
Can
about
you
this
exp
film.
okay, because I can imagine the arguments of, well, these girls are being directed to do these things. They are 11 or 12. Like they are, and they are embodying these things on film.
And that's definitely a concern, and it's something that I think requires a lot of contemplation before going and doing those things. And when I look at the director and I look at the actions and steps she took to try to protect these girls, I do think she was, whether it was misguided or not, trying her best to protect them with such subject matter. Like there was psychologists on the set. They used some Photoshop and different techniques to impose the faces on these girls so they didn't actually have to dance all of those moves like that. They're continued doing psychology, and they talked with the parents and, you know, worked with them and tried to explain what was going on. So there was steps to take to show, okay, I understand what I'm doing. There's a seriousness. And again, I do think that there is an argument to say, well, what line do we cross as filmmakers to get to make a point? And I'm open to having that conversation. And I think there is a conversation to be had. And was there things that she could have left out to make it less explicit and still get her point across? That's definitely an argument to be had. But I think where I'm frustrated is I'm fine to have that conversation, but I think you're ignoring the bigger point that if this movie hadn't happened, all of that stuff would still be happening. And it is happening and it's being celebrated. And you're like a lot of the people who are against this film are participating in that in other
Okay,
ways.
like toddlers and
It's
tiaras come to mind, and like,
Toddlers and Tiaras, Dance Moms. Look at all, like you can go on YouTube and see these dance channels where these tiny girls doing these very adult moves, and we celebrate it. And the point of the film and why she took it so far is to shock people into saying, we are so desensitized by all of this, and this is what it's doing to our kids. Of course, making that film is going to come at a cost. And there comes a point where we have to make that ethical consideration. But it is not as black and white
You
as
shouldn't have made this film. This was
I think.
inappropriate and it's pedophile fodder.
Right. Well, and what I'm frustrated with is you have all of these people who are, with all the best intentions, saying boycott Netflix, they're creating pedophile content. and advertising this to pedophiles. They're taking these clips out of context, putting them on the internet, and sharing it all over the place. If you had just talked about the film in the way that it was, which is a criticism on the hypersexuality of children, like, and not taking the clips out of context in the outside of the frame that they were supposed to be seen in, it would not have as much traction as it does now. And you wouldn't, you're advertising it for people.
Maybe I should take a look at it. Yeah.
Right. And you think, I get frustrated too, because it's like, you think you don't know anybody who's a pedophile. They kind of operate in secret. You probably do, and you don't even know. And so you're trying to do this thing that I think is in some ways well-intended and even good to a extent, to try to get rid of this hypersexualization, but you're drawing people right to it. And you're not really taking into account, because you send somebody to watch Cuties, you don't get anything that's super graphic until like 40 minutes in. And so it's like, if you hadn't overblown this and taken this out of context, you're making it easier
to find the content. The stuff that they're like, yeah, that's the one that the dance moves. That's what I was looking
for. And you're losing. Sorry, the dog is working. You're losing the met. Stop. Sorry.
It's endearing.
You're losing the message of what it's really supposed to be.
It's very uncomfortable at parts. Like, I actually remember being like, watching through my hands, because I was just like, no, why? No, you know, like it. And I actually am thinking about it in a perspective of, this is supposed to be like this. Like, it's supposed to be uncomfortable. It's supposed to be telling us this is what we're doing. Do you remember the movie Little Miss Sunshine?
Yes. Oh, I love that.
I loved it. I love it too. But her dance routine, do you remember it? It was extremely sexualized, like, for the time. Like, you know, whatever. Like, and that was the funny part. Her working on this routine with her grandpa. And, like, I think that everyone is like, whoa, this is, like, I think, like, I don't know if she got booed off the stage. But, like, yeah, people didn't have a good reaction to it. But, like, it was, I think it won awards. Like, there wasn't a backlash against that. But I guess that was only, like, one little bit in the entire film. But that was the same with Cuties, too. There wasn't, not one little bit, but, like you said, it's not really there till about 40 minutes in. And it's almost the way, this is funny. It's funny. And she's like a little bit on the chubbier end. So it's less sexualized, because she definitely looks like a little kid. Yeah. But she's still doing those moves.
Right. Well, and I think there's, the context is so different too, because she's this nerdy little kid.
With the glasses and the olive.
Doing all of these things. Yeah. And just to be fair to Cuties, it did win awards.
Oh, did it?
It got in a lot of festivals. It won awards. Yeah. So it's very beloved by the critics. And, you know, I can understand that. I watched the movie, and I personally thought it was actually really beautiful and, like, technically really well done. Not to say that there isn't disturbing things about that. But I think we're being blinded here. I think we're not looking at this in the full context and being honest with ourselves that there's a lot of things that we watch that we give a pass to because we really like it. You know, and it's not just children. It's children's content. Like, Game of Thrones is a great example. There is so much needless sexuality and nudity that very much is just porn.
Right.
Like, we can just call it what it is. But we give that a pass because the writing's really good and the acting's really good. But those women are still having to do all of those things and be subjected to that. And no, they're not children, but they're still people.
It's true. It is because it was children. Like, I do think that is the difference, because it was children.
I do think there is a difference, but I'll be honest, some of the things that I found the most shocking were the objectification of some of the women and the things that they showed these women doing.
Oh, you mean like of the music videos? Like in Cuties?
Yeah, for me, some of that stuff was almost more revolting than what those kids were doing. Now, of course, I also thought what the kids were doing was revolting.
But they don't know. Whereas these women and these, or even the girls doing, the other girls who are the older, like older teens or even young adults who are also participating in this dance contest, they're like in their late teens, early 20s, I'd say from how they look. Although, you know, they could be 16. I don't know. But they look older for sure and know what they're doing. And they're still doing the moves, I guess. Right. So is that what you mean?
I just watching those women do those things and it's very degrading. Mm-hmm. And I think for me that was something very revealing as I'm watching the film, thinking, man, how glamorized do we make this hypersexualization of adult women? And we say, it's fine, they're consenting mm-hmm. adults. Yet we're putting that content out, and then other young women, 18, 19, their brains aren't fully developed, and that's all of they've seen, and they think that's what I have to do mm-hmm. to operate in this world and get men to like me and all of these things, and it rewires our brain, mm-hmm. and it gives content for these young girls to then watch, and then they repeat, and they're so... their brains are so underdeveloped that they're so susceptible mm-hmm. to it all. Yet we're just blindly letting that happen. I think of all the times where I'm like, well, how many billboards are just like practically naked mm-hmm. women? And how many comedies talk about, you know, sleeping around and like men being really horrific mm-hmm. to women? And, you know, it's funny.
Right.
Like How I Met Your Mother. We've got Barney Stinson, who's like a misogynist and sleeping with everybody, but we give it a pass because Neil Patrick Harris
and he's
hilarious.
Gay, so it's not real.
Yeah, so it's not real, right? But that sort of soft media rewires our brains much more effectively than any sort of other type of media, especially because we consume it without intentionality.
Right, because with Cuties, it is stark. It's like, whoa, what is this? It does make you pause and think. But yeah, the other stuff, when you're just watching it for funsies, you're not on. You're almost like off.
Right.
You're almost like, I just don't want to think. I just want to be entertained. Are you not entertained? I think I just did this. I did that same line in another. I'm doing that a lot.
Well, and I think that's her point too, mm-hmm. right? Like she's pushing it to the edge to get people outside of their desensitized minds. Because if it was just something more passive, we wouldn't be talking right now. Now, of course, there's repercussions to those things, and we need to talk about that. And, like, I do think that there is ways we can look at that, but that's part of what we're doing. And I think for this artist, I would probably argue, without knowing her, she took those calculated risks because she thought that the benefits she would get from having that conversation and changing the way that media is being portrayed mm-hmm. outweighed the negative benefits of making
right.
the film.
And we're talking about it right now, and that's the point. And if you watch it and you're still saying, no, it shouldn't have been made, that's even one conversation compared to, no, I won't watch it.
Right, and I don't even think everybody has to watch it. I think knowing it in its context, and I think there's still people that will say, this shouldn't have been made. And that's a very complicated thing. I don't think it's a black and white
answer. But isn't
answer.
It kind of hard to discuss the only it reason, with someone who's like, I won't watch it?
I mean, I think if you're going to want to have a discussion about it, at the very least, get a synopsis, get a play-by-play. If you don't want to watch those images, watch someone whose life tweeted it, you know, and get the background. I think that's mm-hmm. helpful. I don't think it's helpful. I personally am not a big fan of censorship. I don't think it's actually helpful. I mean, we tried it, right? In the early stages of U.S. film history, we had the Hays Code or the Production Code, which limited what you could show on the screen. And very well intended, but it failed. And it wasn't able to keep up. Mm. And there was a lot of things where it got very tricky and weird. And should there be standards that filmmakers hold themselves up to and think about these things? Absolutely. I think there's far too much unintentionality in making films as filmmakers that becomes dangerous. But I guess I'm not ready to sit and criticize a woman who is trying to stop that hypersexualization. I would rather talk about the things that are celebrated in our culture that are creating a false narrative on sexuality and putting really awful impressions to children mm-hmm. in the world. I mean, Dance Moms, I looked and I went on YouTube and I tried to look up some of those routines. There's stuff on there that they've done that is maybe not as bad, but pretty close. Mm. And that's celebrated. And how many of these moms who are saying, oh, let's cancel that, are tuning in to watch these children get screamed at and, you know, over-sexualized? Mm-hmm. Like, I'd rather have a conversation about that. Mm-hmm. Where were you kicking and screaming when that was on? You weren't, because you didn't even think about it. Now that everybody...
It's just like, remember with the Syrian refugee crisis, and no one cared until the image of the little boy who washed up on shore, who had died in a boating accident off the coast of Greece. And I remember being like, why does everyone care now? Like, I remember when the Christians were all being murdered, and that's why I heard about it. A bunch of ISIS was going after Christians first, and then it was like, well, not just Christians, like that's what I was hearing about in like my little Bible study circles. But lots and lots of people were affected. But the greater media space didn't really care until an image showed up. That was disturbing. And that's what this seems to be a version of.
Well, yeah, and it definitely was disturbing. And I think if you're going to make that film, and I don't know if I would make that mm-hmm. film, like if I had that idea, I don't know if I would want to put my name and make that film and take those risks. But this mm-hmm. woman did, and that was mm-hmm. her choice. But if I were to make that film, you have to take it to that line. I mean, maybe there is a couple things that I could say, oh, maybe you could have edited that down and not shown so much of that. But to get the point across and really get people have a visceral response, you have to take it that far. I had a point to say after that.
What, the image?
Oh, yeah. I think part of what is a little bit irritating to me about this too, it does seem that there's a bit of virtue signaling going on from a group of people who seem to always complain about virtue signaling.
Yep.
And it's like virtue signaling is such a tricky thing, because I think for most people who are doing it, they're not really just trying to do it to look good. I think they want to stand up for what's right. And I think there's good mm-hmm. to that. But taken to the extreme in the social media culture, it creates the snowball where you're fighting for something and you're avidly angry against something that you don't even understand. And so it's like, I understand being upset and like, yeah, I'm against child trafficking, child pornography, you know, hypersexualization. I'm mm-hmm. with you. But this conversation's not helping, and just calling it porn is actually not helpful to a nuanced discussion about this, right? And I know a lot of people don't want to have a nuanced discussion because they say, you know, it's wrong. There's no nuance to it. But I think before you can really convince anybody, especially someone who is maybe more on that liberal end, especially in the media, and think that it's okay. Like, we need to have a discussion of, like, well, what is porn? Because obviously it's not as clear cut as we sometimes like to make it, right? Because you could say, what is porn? Porn's nudity. Well, is it? Not always. Right. And in that sense that sometimes you can have pornographic images, like soft pornography, that's actually not any naked women, but really hypersexualized, scantily clad women that, you know, people get off to. And then you've got things like Schindler's List. There's nudity in that. Yeah. That is not pornographic. Right. But even then, we can have that argument of, like, the psychological damage that you have to have naked people, and I don't know if they had naked children in those scenes, but it's a possibility that they had naked children in those scenes, like, to display the horrificness of what that is. We're playing in the same ballpark. Now, it's a little different because
context.
It is fighting, right? We're fighting hypersexualization by hypersexualizing girls. Yeah.
It is. That is the thing. It's like, no, this is a commentary on why this is not good. And they're using the thing to show what is happening. Because we wouldn't get that message she didn't do that. I think I get what you're saying about if you do go there, you have to push it as far as you can so they can see. So they as an us, so we can see this is what's happening to this point.
Right, yeah. Like, if you didn't see that scene in the laundromat, that's the first moment where you really go, ugh.
Where the girl's dancing, right? Is that what you, yeah.
Yes, but like where it takes it from just this already sexualized dancing, but stuff that's kind of poppy and you would see normally. And then that scene in the laundry room where it takes it to that next level and you go, oh my gosh. If you don't have that moment, this film loses that message. And that's the tricky part. And so, I mean, there's a part of me that's with a lot of the people that are like, yeah, a lot of this is really graphic. But I can't sit and fight with you and say that, fight against this film specifically, because I have seen things online, on Instagram, on YouTube, in movies that are much more horrific, and it's celebrating it. So let's start there. Mm-hmm. Like, let's start there. Like, let's talk about Michael Bay putting a 13-year-old Megan Fox in a tiny bikini under a waterfall.
She was 13?
In one of his films.
Not Transformers, though.
Not Transformers. It was a previous film. I don't remember it. The name of it at the top
of my
head.
She was 13.
But like, she was 13. Let's talk about that. That's
no
disgusting.
Wonder she doesn't like him.
And we're
at
celebrating
all
that
now.
Well, it's complicated. Hollywood is interesting.
Oh
place.
Yeah,
but like, let's talk about that. Or like, and I'm with people with fighting against that in children, but I still think that we need to fight against that with older people too, because just because you turn 18 doesn't mean that hypersexualizing yourself for the pleasure of others and their voyeuristic tendencies is actually a good thing.
You know, it's so funny. I'm just thinking about our conversation is going to be received either as you're saying this is okay. What's wrong with you?
Yeah, we're
or whoa, we're prudes. Look at these girls saying, like, don't be sexualizing yourselves. Like, put the shackles on. Like, you know, it's going to be received in two not close, but very far apart perspectives. And that's the thing that's crazy. Like, but that's because this is hard and it's messy. It's a difficult thing dealing with such things, with sexuality. Particularly in this space for women and their objectification.
Well, I mean, I think watching the film, it was a big wake up call for myself and just the things that I experienced growing up. And I grew up in a pretty conservative Christian household, very sheltered. Mm-hmm. You know, we didn't, I don't think I listened to secular music until I was in the eighth grade.
Like me too.
And we weren't allowed to watch Nickelodeon.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly. The only exceptions were like the Beatles and Jim Croce, and that's just because my dad.
Yeah. The Beatles, and I think Boys to Men for some reason.
Boys to Men?
I know, I think my mom was like, one of them's a Christian. Anyway.
So it makes it all good.
Yeah, I'm glad at least I got that. But anyways, what were you saying?
Well, I just think about, you know, myself growing up, and I remember, and not that I was ever a hypersexualized kid, but I remember certain things, repeating those things and not knowing what we're doing. And like in this context of humor or, you know, all of these different things, like you had Christina Aguilera and Britney Spears and, you know, if you ever go back and watch those, you know, wow, those were a lot. I mean, I remember I was at a bar the other day and they were playing early 2000s music videos and ones that I remember watching like in the eighth grade and going,
whoa.
Oh, wow. These are very provocative. There's a lot going on here. And you're so desensitized to it.
Yeah.
I think every day we're desensitized to it. But like we have children dancing on TikTok. Mm-hmm. We've got, like, you can just search a couple hashtags on Instagram and find that fodder. Mm-hmm. So like the argument that we're opening this
window. It is there.
That window's already wide open.
It is there. And like, this is highlighting in a controlled way.
It's shocking you to realize that it is already there and asking you to pull it back.
Yes.
And so that's why I think for filmmakers, this is a really good conversation to have of like, how do we stop doing this? And it's hard because I think the people who have run Hollywood for so long are men who think that consent is the only
and that's progressive of them. Like, oh, I'm consent. I'm all for it. Yeah. Very progressive of me. Yes.
Yeah. Consent's the only bar for sexuality and that women should celebrate their sexuality. And this is the lie that we've bought into. And of course, there's nothing wrong with women being confident sexually. That's not my argument. I just think the way that we're doing it is actually not empowering the way that we've been sold. It's a false narrative. And I think you're seeing that, especially when you're looking at studies of how women are handling casual sex and different, let me re-say that sentence and you can edit it in. I think you're really starting to see that when you look at the psychological effects that happen with women who are in casual sexual relationships or other sexual experiences. There's negative context to it. Yet we're told everybody's having sex and they're having a lot of fun doing it. But nobody's having as much sex as you think they are. And it's actually not helpful. And in some ways, I kind of feel...
Wait, what's not helpful?
This hypersexualization and this freedom and sexual liberation, it's actually not helping the way that we're sold.
It's a fantasy. It's actually not real. Yeah.
Right. There's a lot of like, have you ever heard of the film Don John?
Yes, I've seen it. Yeah.
You've seen it? Okay. Yeah. So that was one of those films that I contemplated whether to see it or not. Just because I knew what it was about and I was like, do I want this in my brain? But I decided to watch it. I'd never watch it again, but I think there's so much in that film that does create a really good critique of this sexualization and this pornification of our culture.
I think I agree because it is sort of shocking, like a little bit like what you were saying, and I don't need to see it again too. I'm like, oh yeah, I remember seeing that film. But it actually does have a pretty positive message for the end. Near the end.
Well, it had a lot of really important critiques on porn and the way it's rewiring men's brains. It had critiques on women and the way that they use sexuality to attract men. And even rom-coms and other forms of this fantasization to get them to a place where they're, you know, their expectations are off. And I think it even had some pretty powerful things to say about the church and how it dealt with some of that sexuality.
Oh, I didn't even remember. Wow. Yeah. I'll have to have you tell me after, because I'm like, oh no, I've been trying to tell myself I'm going to do an hour, but we're at 56 minutes now.
Oh, we're almost there.
Yeah, but yeah, yeah. Anyway. So, but yeah, this is another film that is shocking in spaces, not as shocking as Cuties, I'd say, but in a different way. Yeah, where it's quite graphic about some things, but it's the message is like, this isn't right how porn is done anymore. Like, and I think the message was, there was some stuff done tastefully in the past. Is that what the message was?
I mean, there was part of that, but I do think that there was something, I think more of it was a critique on some of this addiction to porn.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And how
how the internet has changed
and the
that
relationships and weren't even really mattering to him with these women. It is, yeah, yeah. It just, the videos were more important than actual people, I think, is what, yeah, yeah. Right. But, yeah, yeah. But the thing is, okay, so in the end, like, I'm afraid that this is just going to blow over. That, like, this won't be, well, for some it will, but this, it's like, how dare Netflix have this film on, and that's what this thing is going to be to people, at least in North America. That it's going to be like, oh, why did Netflix choose to do this? And that's the message about Cuties, rather than the message that was supposed to be this is shocking because it's actually happening, and that's the shock. Not that I made the film about it. Like, the film is to show you what's happening already.
Well, I do think Netflix does deserve some criticism for the poster.
Okay.
I think it's just an example of the entertainment industry being a part of the problem again. And, you know, I think they were right to take it down and to apologize.
Do you think this would have gone differently had they not put that picture up and put maybe the French promo?
Yeah, probably. I think people wouldn't have been as outraged.
They wouldn't have even noticed it. And someone would be like, oh, this is in French subtitles. No, thanks.
Yeah, I think some people would watch it. I think a lot of people would pass by and go, oh, what's going on? There might be some outrage. I don't think it would have been the amount of outrage that did happen. So in some ways, is them doing that created a positive conversation? Yes, I also think it's created a negative conversation. I think the best way to fight that negative conversation is to learn how to talk about it better. And I think that's what's really missing. Because I can agree with people, and I can really understand and empathize with people who really don't think that should be made. And I probably disagree with them, but that I say that hesitantly. Because I definitely think that there is issues, but I don't think that the way that the conversation is going is actually helpful, and it's not going to change anybody's minds. And it's actually creating more of a negative feedback loop to stop that conversation from happening in a real positive way that could make any change.
So what is the better way to go about it than with regards to change? Like, it sounded like you were pointing at, like, well, don't, like, let's go to the source. And what's the source? The hypersexualization of women, of age women.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot of things that we can do. I think first, before we freak out and just reshare a post that we don't really know anything about and watching scenes out of context, let's at least understand the context in a real way and not be so closed off and say, I'm not even going to watch it. I don't want to hear it. It's just it's just arguing for porn, like child porn. It's like, Let's not jump there already. Like, let's listen a little bit more and be more intentional with our words, because the words that are being used on both sides are not bridging real understanding. I think the second thing is, before we start criticizing things that are actually with you on the issue, can we reevaluate the things that we consume every day that might be leading to some of this hypersexualization of children, and be more critical about what we're consuming. And I'm not even arguing necessarily that we don't watch it, although I think some things you can make an argument that we probably shouldn't watch. And I do think the only way we can, I don't think we should legislate what people should and shouldn't watch. Right. I think you do have to come to an individual standard.
They did that in England, right, with the Beachbody ad. They legislated. Did they? Yeah, you're no longer allowed to advertise with certain. I don't know the details, but it was a thing last year. Yeah.
Oh, really? Well, I mean, there already are those laws. I mean, like with cigarettes, you can't do cigarette ads anymore.
Yeah, that's true.
There are certain things that do exist, and I think there's a place to maybe have that conversation. I just think we have to acknowledge that it is a double-edged sword, and things can get out of control very quickly when we start asking for censorship. Mm-hmm. I think there are things that are bad for us to watch, and I don't think everything should be watched. Mm. And I think we need to come together and have a conversation about that. But I would want to focus more on maybe let's stop watching these things that mindlessly promote dangerous situations for children, like Dance Moms or whatever, Toddlers and Tiaras.
And such things, yeah. Like, yeah. Why did it take so long? For this to come up, and it took a French movie that people are mad about the poster.
All right, and the last thing I would say too is I think parents, I think, need to take a more active role in talking to their kids about those things. I think that's really what it's talking about. And you know, that scene in the movie where she's watching this really raunchy dance moves in a prayer service. Mm-hmm. Your kids, your 11-year-old has a phone. They have access to as much porn as they want. They're seeing much more graphic things than that. And I think it is a wake-up call to say, oh, hey, this is having an effect. And if we're not paying attention and not talking to our kids about this stuff in a really influential way, they're going to start coming up with their own ideas of what all of this is, because that was the big part of it too, right? You have all of these 11-year-olds saying things about sex, but they don't know what they're talking about because they're all just learning from each other. It's like, talk to your kids about sex.
Yeah.
Give them more understanding of why maybe it's bad for them to consume those things and what it can do, and treat them like they're part of the conversation, because I think that was a big criticism too of like, what are you doing? Just shutting it down, where it's like, and I think that moment at the end with the mother, like really understanding kind of what was going on with this girl was really beautiful, where it's not, she doesn't know what she's doing. She's repeating things. And I think seeing what's really going on and what kids actually have exposure to just gives us more of a chance to figure out how do we help kids navigate that better? Because right now they're navigating it blindly. And they need guidance. And, like, we as adults should provide that guidance.
And I don't see the internet changing. Like, I don't see, even though we literally just discussed it. Like, oh, this would be great if this and the hypersexualization of women and blah, blah, blah. But, like, I don't, as much as I like to be optimistic, I don't think it's going to change anytime soon. Advertisements, even if television and movies tried to alter things, like sex sells, and you're like, these ad agencies are like, oh, I'm not gonna stop, you know? So it does seem to be the most change you can have an effect on is talking to your kids, keeping an eye on them with regards to technology.
And I don't think it's gonna stop. But what I do think is that people in my position who are filmmakers, we can make a decision of whether we continue.
Right.
And we can make a decision what we put out into the world. So I think there is something to be said about artists taking on that call and trying to fix the problem in that way and creating content that is okay for kids to watch.
Right. Oh, actually, we never talked about, I don't even know what Cuties is rated, but it is not for children to watch, I'm guessing.
No, I think it was rated TV mature.
Okay.
So this is not, it was not marketed for children. It was marketed for an adult mm-hmm. audience. And it was not meant, whether you think it's porn or not, it was not meant to be porn. It was meant to be a social criticism. So we can take that at least into account in how we understand this film. Mm-hmm. But again, I think sometimes, I do think there is an argument that sometimes people say, oh, it's art, so it's not porn. And it's like, no, but that's just
okay.
porn.
Yeah, that does happen sometimes, yes.
And that does happen sometimes. I would not go as far to say that this film is that, but it's definitely got some hard to swallow scenes. Mm-hmm. And things that I would not necessarily recommend everyone going watching and having those images in your brain.
Right. I think that is good that you say you don't have to watch it, and you're not even saying everyone should be watching it, and that it's okay to feel offended by it. But I think it's something that, be careful about saying it shouldn't have been made.
Yeah. I mean, I would say okay. So. I mean, I don't think that it shouldn't have been
right.
made. I think that would be a hard thing
yeah.
to say. I mean, it's hard too, because like, I'm not a fan of censorship, because I don't think it actually helps. Mm-hmm. But I'm also on this spectrum where it's like, I wish porn didn't exist. I think it's really harmful. I think it's disgusting and really terrible for women and men mm-hmm. too. But like, just women in the industry get treated so awfully. I wish it did not mm-hmm. exist. But me legislating that it doesn't exist doesn't make it mm-hmm. go away. It just
pushes it into the
in
shadows. Hiding. Yeah.
Right. And that's where it becomes trickier. Mm-hmm. So I'm more frustrated about the clipping and the taking things out of context with that mm-hmm. film than it being made.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, because I think that is making the problem worse.
Right. So find context. I'm sure everyone will from now on.
Context is key. Yeah, and I know people are going to give us a lot of hate for these things, but I don't care.
I don't know. I really don't know. I have seen mixes. So I'm curious
yeah.
to see the comments.
I mean, I definitely think there are people in the middle who think the same things that we're saying and are having these discussions behind closed doors. But as far as going out and putting something public, I think much less people are willing to go out and say a statement like that than either one of the extremes.
And it's the fact that we're both women discussing this. Even that context is different from a man talking to a woman, or two men talking about, oh yeah, this was so good. It opens the eyes. And like, it was difficult to watch. Like,
right.
I would believe if a man says, oh, yeah, it was very difficult to watch. Cause I know a lot of men who would be like protective of their daughters. And so who would be like
right.
that, you know, but it's, being a woman watching this, I felt like I think I would feel a degree of being safe to watch it, as opposed to,
yes, that's how I felt, and that's why I watched it. It's like there's nothing appealing to me about watching little mm-hmm. girls dance mm-hmm. inappropriately. Like there's nothing that I want to see
yeah.
about that. And so I do think for men, I think men are just wired differently. I think they are much more image driven than women. And so I could see it being much harder for a man to watch that than a woman.
And they may even be only feeling protective impulses to give the
right.
best reading of it. But to discuss it the way we're discussing it, I think that could be difficult.
Yeah, I think it is an advantage that
yes.
we're women. And we can say some of the difficult things that maybe a man can't say.
And I think that the fact that it is a woman who made this film, that kind of changed it a little bit even for me when I found that out as well.
Yeah.
So, I don't know, context matters.
I mean, yeah, it does, and it's very complicated. I don't think that all of the disgust and outrage is wrong, but I also think that that's what it's supposed
right.
to do. It's supposed to outrage, it's supposed to disgust you, and it did a brilliant job.
Did the job it set out to do. Yes.
But I think when I watch the film as a whole, and I especially the beginning, I remember just crying and just feeling and really understanding, and even though I didn't experience those things, but empathizing mm-hmm. with that and thinking, oh wow, and seeing how some of these things are all connected in this mess of what is hypersexualization of children.
Well, I even though I'm like, where should we wrap up? And then I'm like, I'm gonna bring up a yeah. story about, like, I remember, I don't even know what ages, maybe junior high, high school, probably mixed between, like, we'll say, yeah, mid junior high and up, always for choosing my clothes, like, will I look pretty in this to the boys?
I remember my dad was very protective of us. And so, like, we would always have to get our clothes checked by him before we could wear them.
Really?
And I remember being, yes. Yeah, so he was very, I'm telling you, it was very sheltered. Mm-hmm. And I don't hold it against them because I think they were just doing the best that they could. But I remember being in tears, like in high school, crying because my dad wouldn't let me keep a skirt that I wanted. And it was just like, I didn't see it in the way that they saw it. And I think some of their, like, we could only wear shorts that went to our knees, like, and we couldn't wear spaghetti straps. So some of the things were extreme, but, like, in some ways I'm sort of grateful for that. And sometimes I look at, like, stuff that I wore when I was 18 and I'm like, oh my gosh, those shorts are way too short. I should not have been
wearing
those.
Wish I would have brought this up while I'm saying it now, but, like, in the censorship time when we're back when you mentioned about that, because I about it going into the shadows, because I actually remember I was visiting my aunt in Dallas back when I was like 15, and she took us to Ross, and she was like, oh, you girls need new bathing suits, I'll buy you some bathing suits. And I found a two-piece that was like boy shorts, you know, those like little kind of boy cut shorts but for like girls, and then a uh-huh. top that it wasn't triangle, it was just like a cross and straps. And then she told uh-huh. my mom that night about it, and my mom was like, oh, no, that doesn't sound appropriate. And so then she had to return it. And then I went and found some like way more scandalous bikini somewhere in some store at the mall and just hid it and wore it to camp.
Yeah.
Like, it was just hidden, and that is exactly like I literally hid it in the shadows. Like, I was like, oh, okay, well, I had something that was definitely more modest, but you made me take that back. And so I found something. It wasn't that I wanted to find something that was less modest, I just couldn't find that. I just couldn't find the thing that I liked, and so this was all that was there. And so I'm like, hey, well, I want a two-piece, so that is, but that's like a, like, that's kind of like a very mild version of the, like, okay, well, cover yourself up completely for your religious beliefs in that culture. But then she goes out and, like, unzips the hoodie and has the little, like, crop top underneath, you know, it's.
Right. And I'm not knocking modesty. I think there's a need for it. And I value that. And I, even though I do think, like, some of the things that my parents did were maybe extreme.
You can't suppress it, though. Like, that's the thing. You can't, like
right.
you can't, you can't control everything your kids do. Like that's the thing that I'm thinking of. You can do your best and try to teach them why, and they accept it or
right.
they don't.
And I think just leveling with kids and giving them, and I think that's why for me I never really rebelled against a lot of it. Like, there were some times where I'm like, you're being ridiculous, I, you know, the skirt is almost to my knees, why can't I have it? But I think they were always explaining why they did right. these things and why. And so I think because they leveled with me and treated me like I could handle the reasons, it helped me navigate it a lot better. And I think that's not always happening right. with children.
Totally. I think that, yeah, treating them like they get to have a reason why as opposed to just because, yeah.
Right. The kids are much smarter than we give them credit for, and they can understand a lot. And I think if you just level with them, and you don't have to treat them like an adult, but you level with them and give them more than just because I said so and it's not appropriate, they can understand that, and they can feel like they're not just being told to do something because, you know, you're trying to not make
life fun. Yeah, life yeah, fun. Totally.
Cool.
You know? I remember feeling like that. So. Anyways. Okay, well, I think, okay, this was got a little bit of personal anecdotes at the end, so making it more personal. So
I hope this was fine. I feel like I got caught in the weeds.
No, it was good. No, I really appreciate you coming on the show to discuss a controversial thing that I get why it's controversial, but I don't at the same time. Maybe people can write me. I'm sure they will. But it's something that I think a light was shined on a space that's really needing light on it. So this was, yeah. I'm really pleased that we got this out as quickly as we did.
Yeah.
So, yay. Yeah. Woohoo.
I'm glad to be
able to. Yeah. Okay, well, thank you so much, Cassie. I appreciate your professional opinion.